Hi guys, Matt Easton here. So I'm here with famous American instructor Scott Brown, who's over in the UK at the moment. He's been travelling around all over Europe in the last couple of months, I think, but we can talk about that in a moment. And he's here at the moment in the UK. He's teaching at Fight Camp, which is the event that I run once a year in August in the Midlands of the UK. And he's also been teaching at a couple of clubs. He's teaching at my club tonight, for example, in London. Scott, first things first, I wanted to ask you, how did you get into HEMA and what was your sort of background before you got involved with the HEMA movement?
It's a pretty exciting story, but essentially, you know, I had done Asian martial arts my whole life. I have a pretty strong background in various Eskrima arts, and in particularly Japanese arts, Aikido being probably the most prolific. And I was running an Aikido club in St. Louis. A wonderful gentleman by the name of Leonard Volker came in and trained with us for a while. He didn't last too long because at that time he was already, you know, he had been doing martial arts for nearly 50 years, and he had a bad knee, so he couldn't take the rolling and falling and getting up so much. So he didn't last but a week or two. He came back about a week later at the end of the class one evening, and he had a wacer, a wooden sword. And, you know, after class, I went up to him and said, "Hey, Leonard, how's it going?" And the short story is that he said, "Do you have any interest in learning swords?" And in my arrogance, I said, "Well, I think I know a thing or two about swords, having mucked around with the Bokken in Aikido for a while."
Yeah.
He invited me around his house that Sunday, and of course I went. And the short version is that I ended up leaving about 4 hours later, and I threw my swords in the car, and I threw my bag in the car, and drove home grumbling and very unhappy, saying to myself basically, you know, 20 years of martial arts and I'm still getting my ass kicked by old men. I've always said there's two types of martial artists: those who get an enlightenment like that and leave and, you know, pretend it never happened and never go back, and those that want to figure out what happened, what went wrong, and go back. So I did the following weekend. That very quickly turned into a bunch of my guys from my Aikido club going with us over there, and we had a very exciting club going very quickly.
Cool. So that was an interesting thing you mentioned, because I don't think you mentioned that in that way to me before, but I've experienced myself actually, particularly in Asian martial arts, they sometimes mix sort of katana or bokken into, I've known a karate teacher who did it, and they don't necessarily know anything about swordsmanship at all, but I think as a way of building up the curriculum, they add in a weapon into what's essentially an unarmed martial arts system. And I have to say, I think this is true in both Chinese and Japanese martial arts to an extent. And I think in recent years, with more specialization in certain types of armed martial arts, it's probably, maybe it's easier to spot. But do you think that that's quite prevalent, actually, that there are martial arts instructors who do unarmed and a weapon, but because they don't really focus on the weapon, they don't necessarily actually understand how armed combat is supposed to work?
Yeah, I do. And I probably would even go so far as to say we see a bit of that in HEMA as well, but certainly in Asian arts, you get, you know, just as in HEMA, you get these extreme spectrums of these guys who have gone and studied a system and they understand that they're, you know, propagating or continuing a specific system, and they're very rigid about staying within that confines. And then, of course, you get the opposite side where you have folks who are running, you know, perhaps say a successful karate club. They want to add more to the program for whatever reasons, and then, you know, so they take a few weekend seminars or get some books and their own experiences and add to it. Are they often, you know, using supportable systems, either, you know, lineages passed down word of mouth? Sometimes, perhaps, but often probably not. These days I don't spend as much time in the Asian martial arts dojos as I used to, so, but yeah, I certainly run into that from time to time. And
So going back to your story, where did you go from there? What happened next?
Well, effectively, it became a weekend thing, and it became a passion of mine very quickly. Leonard was superb in that, you know, he had been reading and gathering as much information as he could, and he had quite a bit, comparatively speaking, in those days. So he exposed me to, you know, just dozens of different manuscripts and manuals, and that was the thing that really turned the light bulb on for me. You know, I had been introduced to things like SCA through friends over the years, and you know, some reenactment, and I had gone and had a look at them, but had never gotten excited about them because, you know, where I was at in life, and I just didn't see it as, you know, I saw it as some guys playing, perhaps unfairly, but that's what I saw at the time. But when Leonard introduced me to the actual manuscripts, and I could see, you know, like grappling techniques that were, you know, nearly identical to things that I was doing in Asian martial arts, that really piqued my interest, and I became quite obsessed with it rather quickly. And he was very good as a sort of mentor about forcing me to read more and more and more. As did some others later on in my HEMA career. And, you know, the more I learned, the more I wanted, and I became obsessed with it, you know, as a personal thing, and it was my weekend deal, but I was thinking about it all through the week. And, you know, because I had been doing so much unarmored stuff, I became enthralled with the armored stuff, the armed stuff.
Yeah.
And because it was so different. You know, I understood a bit about grappling, so I didn't focus so much on that. I wanted to work on the stuff I didn't have skill sets for. And in a very short amount of time, I found myself moving away from the Asian martial arts into the Western martial arts. And it wasn't long, I think within a year, I had moved my Aikido club from renting at a karate dojo, and I had, you know, opened my own business, and we had several things, several arts displayed there. But one of them I made a point of was having a longsword class, which Leonard originally taught, and then I took over later. So we were probably one of the earliest sort of places with a shingle teaching HEMA in the U.S.
Cool. And so, from a personal level, had you always been interested in weapons or in history, or was it just a martial arts mechanics sort of thing for you? What?
You know, as a kid, I had all these varied interests. I mean, I don't know any child from literally anywhere around the world, boy or girl, that doesn't pick up a stick and immediately turn it into a sword, you know.
Yeah.
And I definitely did that. I know that, you know, my father and my brothers, we had made amazing cardboard kits, shields and swords, very early on. So I had always had that same interest. But because I had gotten into Aikido quite early, I think I had actually taken more of a peaceful approach, you know, go along to get along type of attitude. And I think, in fact, that was partly what perhaps attracted me about the sword arts, was that, you know, it was not this, like, you know, turn the other cheek all the time mentality. It was, no, stand your ground and go get it.
Yeah.
Or not.
And what about the history aspect? Is that, how do you view that?
Well, that was the thing, in addition to the manuscripts, that really hooked me. It wasn't just, you know, here's some moves, learn these moves and do them. It was, you know, you had to read more and more to understand the historical, you know, first of all, timelines and locales, but then, you know, getting into historical contexts. And, you know, I've said for many years, most of us, once we graduate, you know, high school or university, we don't actually do much learning the rest of our lives. And I found that that was just super intriguing to me, that, you know, I was gluttonous about, you know, trying to get the next thing and the next thing, and everything I learned meant that I had to learn three more things to better understand that. And I find that's one of the valuable things. Matt Gallis says something that I shamelessly adopt, and he says, one of the great things about HEMA is that it doesn't matter, you know, if you get bored of one section or burnt out, you know, say you get a little bit burnt out on training every day or something, you can jump over to transcription or translation mm-hmm. or research or, you know, historical context. So there's, you know, there's many facets to keep mm-hmm. you intrigued and interested.
So what's your current focus?
Ironically, I've kind of come full circle. After, you know, running clubs in Houston and St. Louis, and now I live in Orlando, where because longsword was quite popular and that's what people wanted, you know, I had shifted an emphasis over to longsword. But my first and true passion, you know, obsession in HEMA was sword and buckler. Again, because it was something that, first of all, I mean, no one hardly knows what a buckler is even to this day.
Hopefully that's changed a bit with this channel. But.
Yeah, hopefully. And I sort of feel at this point that, I'm quite comfortable that HEMA is going to endure, both as a practice and as an interest and a hobby and an industry. And longsword having been the large focus of that, I think that's great, but I think it's also sort of important that we put emphasis now on other aspects. I mean, frankly, the longsword had a very minor role in European military or civilian contexts, whereas the sword and buckler was infinitely more relevant.
And this is something I'm intending to talk about in a video coming up, is that sometimes the weapons that get focused on the most in modern HEMA are not necessarily, it doesn't represent the weapons which were most popular either in civilian life or in warfare. So a typical example is, 19th century, lots of people focus on sabre, but of course the bayonet was the main hand-to-hand weapon, and there are very, very few people really focusing on the 19th century bayonet sources. Equally, in a medieval context, the messer, incredibly common sidearm right the way across a large part of Central Europe, more in other parts of Europe, particularly like England and France, the sword and buckler was far more common for far more people than the longsword ever was. But because the longsword appears in these treatises, because it was the noble, it was the gentlemanly sort of sword par excellence for a period of about 100 years, it really and becomes adopted as, I suppose, the effectual, kind of one of the main weapons of the effectual, the fencing weapon, essentially. It gets a lot of focus because there's a lot of material written on it.
Well, and that's interesting, even looking only in the confines of the longsword classes, which is, you're right, originally it was an upper class, a knightly class related weapon, but it had a very short lifespan in that context. As the burgher classes rose, particularly in Central Europe, under the Holy Roman Empire and France and whatnot, then the longsword became adopted because they were emulating, you know, their heroes or those who they thought were in a higher station. And the longsword probably really had more of a lifespan under a recreational fencing environment, more so than it ever did as a war weapon.
Certainly, I mean, we know even by the late 16th century, it wasn't really a major weapon to be carried on the battlefield, and yet it was very popular still in the fencing schools and in the use of the spadone or the zweihänder, whatever you want to call it, the large two-handed sword survived in the fencing schools right the way through, in fact until the early 18th century in some places.
Which is at opposition with what I see, at least in a lot of modern mentalities, which is where everyone is focusing on the war mentality, the dueling mentality of the longsword, when and yet they sort of dismiss the recreational aspects of the longsword, which in reality should probably be flipped.
Yeah, you know? And one of the most sort of expansive sources for the longsword, of course, is Joachim Meyer. Yeah. And Joachim Meyer's book is, to a certain extent, you could say it's almost catered towards recreational fencing rather than battlefield sort of or dueling application.
Yeah. But I think that can be said of probably more sources than people want to admit.
So your focus is the sword and buckler. Do you look at all sword and buckler sources, or particular areas, or particular periods?
Well, certainly I try to read as much as I can and practice and interpret as many of the different sources as I can. linguistic skills, having some occasional limitations, but luckily I have a lot of friends. But these days I'm more focused on getting back to the thing that I was first attracted to, which was the 133 sword and buckler system. I've shifted the focus in my local club to being a predominantly buckler club with a side emphasis on longsword rather than the way it used to be, which was mostly longsword and a little bit of buckler. And I focus on two aspects. One is developing fundamental swordsmanship skills and related to buckler particularly. And then our current, you know, obsession is, despite a lot of talk and whatever, I really don't see the mechanics, the techniques of 133 occurring in a lot of free play. I suppose unless you slow it down.
By free play you mean sparring and fencing, competitive.
And so our emphasis is developing, you know, I'm refining curriculum that I've developed in the past and developing new curriculum with the express intent to draw out those techniques and those skills and those mechanics so that it's a commonplace occurrence within the club. And then hopefully here in the near future we'll start showcasing that around and see what we can do.
And I think that's an important thing, because we've spoken in the past about competition and its place in HEMA, and from the outset, one of the roles of competition in HEMA is to try and encourage and foster techniques and patterns of behaviour that marry up with what we see in the treatises, rather than just creating a new modern sword sport that has no connection to history or reality or life and death fighting. Because, you know, the guys that wrote these treatises were there at the time, using the right weapons in the right context, you know, in potentially preparing for life or death situations. So they presumably developed the best ways of doing things. So I think it's important that we do try to always pull ourselves back to not just training to win, but also training to do well or win whilst using techniques that are historical.
Yeah, I mean, and that is going to continue to be an ongoing challenge, I think, for both tournament hosts and writers of rules, as much as competitors. You know, as you say, most of the folks putting on tournaments in the early days really wanted them to be a vehicle, a platform for techniques to be presented from manuscripts. As time goes by, I think you're seeing this dynamic shift where you've got people who, you know, it's nice to be able to say, our club has 17 gold medals. That must make us valid, but, you know, if you start analyzing and you see, well, actually, you're really good at these three techniques over and over and over again, hey, that's great for those three techniques, but we still, at that point, we're moving away from getting the rest of the manuscripts displayed. Now, context matters. You know, some of those things perhaps cannot be, arguably or competently reconstructed under the confines of a tournament setting. But I think we can often get a little farther than three. But there is a challenge in doing so, obviously. Yeah.
So, changing topics slightly now, you've been travelling around Europe to HEMA events, teaching at and attending HEMA events and competing at HEMA events. Well, you've been travelling around America as well, but Europe and America. From your point of view, at this point in time, what are the notable differences, if there are any, between the HEMA scene in Europe and the HEMA scene in America?
Education is probably the number one thing. I think that, you know, look, you have people who are new both in Europe and in the US, and newer people obviously have less information. I think that you have a more of a drive in Europe to continue to work towards historical contexts and to keep history in its place, sort of thing, if that makes, perhaps it's not the best way to phrase it, but hopefully you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. I think there's a little more of a tendency, particularly with the incoming crowd in the US, that this is a fun, exciting
sport,
yeah. And the emphasis on, you know, moving towards historical context it's not as severe. I've heard a lot of people say, well, you know, it's European culture, and so therefore it's more sensible that they would be more dedicated that way. But I have to dismiss that argument frequently because, first of all, there's a significant portion of the United States that has their heritage in Europe. Mm. So I don't buy that argument, frankly.
And in fact, frankly, the United States have existed for a fair amount of time now, and a lot of behemoth sources are from a period of time when the USA existed. So if you're studying 19th century sources like I do, there are some excellent American sabre and bayonet sources, just as there are British and German and everything else. So.
And almost no one's looking at them, yeah.
I think that's a great... I mean, I've noted this, and I know we've spoken about it in the past, but I think it's a great shame that there aren't more Americans looking at the American HEMA sources, because they're actually quite a large number. And, you know, there are some excellent sabre sources that are American and, you know, purely American. They're not just a copy of a French or an English source. They're in sort of indigenous as much as you can be in the 19th century.
Yeah.
What about other differences in, the competition scene? You touched on that. Do you think that there's a general difference between competitions in Europe and competitions in the States, or are they quite similar?
I will definitely say that I think there is a larger emphasis on competition for competition's sake in the US. You certainly have that in Europe, but I think, you know, looking at an overview, I think there's still a fairly open-minded and committed mentality amongst the many of the Europeans that we're still exploring ideas and how we're going to go with this thing. Whereas in the States, I see this hurried, you know, sort of desire. We've got to standardize it and ritualize it, and I think in some regards that's probably good, you know, for safety reasons and whatnot. But I don't see the same emphasis on trying to, you know, like my personal disappointment is that I don't see the same emphasis on historical rules. There have been a number of tournaments over the summer, and a large portion, if not the bulk of the discussion afterwards, has been focused around who won this or that tournament, but not the ones that are the historical based. There's not a lot of discussion about, okay, we tried this rule set, now this part I think might be closed, this part is certainly wrong, or maybe it's right, but we didn't get it, or we don't understand it. So, you know, they're not focusing on as much on that side of it, and, you know, I care more about that side. Perhaps that's just a personal thing, but as much as we originally wanted these tournaments to be vehicles for testing, pressure testing, historical technique, the more information we get on the historical formats, I think that also needs to be emphasized just as strongly, because I think we're starting to see that, yeah, we have this idea that their tournaments must have been all about recreating the duel or recreating this, but it's clear, becoming clearer and clearer that that was not always the case. And if that's not always the case, we need to understand why. And if we avoid, you know, looking at those historical contexts and those historical practices, we're certainly not going to get closer by ignoring it. So, you know, I think competition, even modern competitions, are good and healthy. You know, they create an industry, but I think they run a very real danger of, and I think you see this in the U.S. as well, of basically, you know, in the Asian arts, you generally have these guys who compete, and then you have the so-called traditionalists who only do, you know, kata and the forms and whatever, and the two worlds occasionally collide, but it's not the norm. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, even in the Japanese sword arts, you have the guys who cut, but don't kendo, yeah. And the guys who kendo rarely do iaido, or they do some, but they don't cut. And so there's this isolation, and I think especially in the U.S. tournament scene now, you're starting to see this pretty open emulation of the Asian arts. You know, there's now form competitions in the U.S., and I know that this has been talked about in Europe over the years, and while it's a, you know, on the surface, and there's people that put together some intelligent-sounding
reasons,
defenses, yeah, for that. Yeah. In reality, I think that it's just that, it's searching for arguments that sound plausible. Because, first of all, you have the interpretation process. How can anybody, if you're going to make literally a subjective review of somebody's performance and go, well, you're the gold medalist and you're the silver medalist of this thing, we really don't know what it is, but I think you're prettiest at it.
So it's like judging figure skating or dance, essentially. It's,
yeah, yeah, what
it's,
else can
it's
it
very
be?
Subjective, yeah.
Take, for example, there are a number of clubs that focus only on ringgek, okay? Mm. And they often have very similar interpretations, but different methods of evaluating it. Now, some of these guys in support of these forms tournaments will go, oh, well, we're not evaluating their interpretation, we're evaluating their sense of balance, their timing, their intent. Which is always my, what does that mean, intent? And that sounds plausible, but what happens if the guys who always make their Zwerchau on one, you know, with one foot in the air because they're transiting to another step,
yeah,
are more successful than the guys who plant their feet?
It's all so subjective, and of course, different systems can, what one system says is good, another system might say is bad. It's very difficult to judge. So, bring it a bit of background to your views of HEMA and the way it's going. Where do you think is the next? Where do you see HEMA going from here? How do you think it will change compared to the current?
Well, I think that you're going to see, much like in sport fencing, the competitions will, you know, sort of solidify and become an industry unto themselves. That's already happening. I think that's going to continue. I think you'll also see, sort of like in the Asian arts, where the guys who perhaps don't do as well as in competition, you know, begin the dialogue of, well, we stick to the manual, we stick to the sources. And so there'll be a fracturing of these different groups based on this sort of thing. Not so much a fracturing as much as, you know, they just sort of coagulate into their separate groups by design.
Yeah.
I hope, and you know, I see a lot of what you do and many other groups, but I hope there will be a newfound emphasis on expanding HEMA beyond just this longsword-centric ideal.
Mm.
You know,
I think that's happening now. I mean, there's a rapidly increasing number of people who, I mean, for years I would say rapier and longsword have been the two most popular things. And in the last 2 years, you're seeing sabre groups and sword and buckler groups and small sword groups and all sorts of other aspects of HEMA springing up. And some clubs like my own who've moved from a focus on, and yours indeed, from a focus on one weapon to maybe studying two or more weapons, and sometimes then dropping the original weapon as the focus. So I think that's definitely happening a lot. And I think it's also inevitable that there will be, as the community grows, there will be a bit like sort of tectonic plate movement. There will be a gradual movement away of some groups moving away from each other, both in terms of how much they have contact with each other, but also in terms of how they actually, what they do and how they do it.
Well, I agree, and in some regards I think that's healthy, because that means that we're growing up to the point where we can sort of isolate into our own collective interests. I think that's going to be another change that you'll see. It's already begun, but I think it will become increasingly prevalent that events will become either system specific or weapon specific. You know, there's a great event, the International Sabre Symposium now. I just came from an event, the Rolfsfechten Symposium, which was that was pretty exciting, frankly.
Rossfechten being horse fighting, German for horse fighting,
yeah,
so mounted fighting.
And, you know, where the emphasis was on, you know, equestrian-related aspects of HEMA. That was pretty cool because it really sort of felt like the early days of HEMA where, you know, you had all these people interested in horses, but often from different backgrounds, and also their interests in different aspects of the HEMA-related systems were different, but they wanted to get together, do this thing, and start figuring out how can we move this forward. So that was really exciting. But yeah, I think this sort of specialization is coming, and I think as long as that continues, as they be, those events are supported by people, that will continue to expand HEMA into wider and wider circles.
Okay, so to finish off, this has been a fairly long video, I know, but I'm sure you've all enjoyed watching it. To finish off, Scott is a supplier of equipment in the United States. He supplies equipment for various different manufacturers, including Peter Regnier's swords and the well-known sparring gloves. I want to talk to you a bit about that, ask how you got into that and how that's going, but also where do you think is the next step for HEMA equipment? What would you like to see develop next?
Well, I got into it because I basically got strong-armed into it. in the States, there was a need for some of the equipment. I was bringing equipment back from my club, and then people kept asking me, well, can you bring a couple for our club? At the same time, the manufacturers over here were like, we don't know anybody over there, we trust you, will you do this? So I sort of got into it by accident. I'm trying to do it fairly well. And it's going fairly good, I think.
Does your business have a name?
HEMA Supplies.
Okay, HEMA Supplies. We'll put some manner of link up. I think it'll be a Facebook link.
There's a Facebook link. We're working on the website. Hopefully it won't be much longer now. But where do I think it's going? I think you're going to see a refinement in equipment. I think that, you know, a lot of the emphasis on developing equipment in the early days has been to develop equipment that is sort of universal, so a rapier fella could use it, and a longsword, and a whatever. I think that will continue because that's the most economical way for people. It is a fairly expensive hobby to get into.
Although maybe not to get into at the beginning, if you're just training techniques and stuff, but yeah, to get all of the sparring equipment and compete, then that gets expensive.
Yeah, and it's not super expensive compared to other, you know, hobbies.
It's comparable just with kendo or perhaps sport fencing.
But I think you'll also see some specialization in equipment. For example, I'm beginning to talk with some manufacturers now because I've been concerned for a while that the masks we're using are perhaps not up to the job. I've been closely, in the US there's a big, long, very well-funded study going on where the NFL, the National Football League, and the US Armed Forces are working on studies to monitor, you know, injury to the brain, concussions and whatnot, and develop better helmets for our soldiers and our athletes. to minimize that stuff. And I have concerns that, you know, some of us are taking, those who can't parry, are taking some pretty severe hits to the head, and often, you know, when you're taking multiple hits to the head night after night after night, they may not be doing much, but they may be doing some damage. These micro-concussions, I believe, is the term, where you don't even realize you're having it.
Perhaps most famously documented in boxing cases, which, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that was, they thought, well, we'll add the gloves to make everything safer, and it ended up creating different problems.
Yeah.
And we're using masks that were not designed for this degree of hitting, you know. Mm. Even the Sabre coaches' masks, they were designed for a little more rough and tumble than, you know, the foil or the épée, but certainly not long swords and, you know, yeah, cavalry sabers and whatnot.
It is interesting to note that in the 19th century they had special masks for that looked superficially like a fencing mask, but made for bayonet and military saber, and they are more bulky. They didn't call them masks, incidentally; they called them helmets, and they're more bulky and protected around the side and top and back. And some of them have kind of raised bars, actually, so that the impact kind of, it's almost like a suspension system, so that the shock is taken out before it reaches your head.
Yeah, for example, most of us are wearing a fencing mask with a very thin layer of padding on the inside, and then the rigid protection on the outside, and then we pad the outer side. Well, but yeah, football helmets, American football helmets, are typically padded on the inside with the rigid protection on the outside. So should we be looking at that, where the more significant padding is on the inside versus the outside? But then you get into issues like, you know, Jeff Tsai and a number of other groups have now started to run, like at the IGX event, they've run dagger tournaments. Well, fencing masks don't work very well for dagger tournaments because they come off so easily. So do we need a mask that can stay on, or yeah, would we like a modular mask you can clip a part on that will keep it on for, yeah, grappling? And or is using the mask as a grappling tool going to become an artifact? You know,
for me, one of the big worries with masks as they currently are is the back of the head, and there are some commercially available back of head protectors, but for a combination of reasons, including being too expensive for what they are, frankly, and also not fitting masks very well. I bought one and it didn't fit my mask even remotely, and I'll do a review of that at some point. But a back of head is incredibly vulnerable in here, and of course a fencing mask, the back of the head's not a concern with this sport fencing because you're on a piste and it's very linear. For us it's a big concern, and I kind of think that we almost need something that is a bit like a close helmet that closes around front and back and completely encapsulates your head, and then therefore it wouldn't fly off when grappled or such like as well. But yeah, so masks definitely need improving or looking at. What about gloves?
I think gloves will still continue to be approached.
What do you think are the current kind of top level gloves for?
I definitely think that the sparring gloves are still probably the best option in terms of level of protection provided, you know, ease of availability. You know,
These are the Polish brand known simply as sparring glove. So it won't help you find it very easily on Google because they didn't pick a very sensible name.
Yeah.
But the company is called Sparring Glove, and they're a Polish company, and
yeah.
Scott imports them into the US. You can buy them in the UK directly from the Polish company.
Yeah, sparringgloves.com is how you would search for them. Spess has a new glove out that I think looks very promising. I think it may have some maintenance related issues like some of the other gloves. You know, there's a guy in the US, Jeremiah Backhouse, who made some wonderful finger gauntlets, and they do a good job, but they're very susceptible to a lot of maintenance issues, so there's a trade-off there.
And I should mention, but Spez and the sparring gloves are both mitten gloves, so they're very good level of protection, but you don't have much mobility of the fingers, and so I personally have always not gone towards those gloves because I do mainly sabre and I don't want to have different pairs of gloves for different weapons, so I've gone for fingered gloves because I do mostly sabre, and you need the mobility of the fingers for sabre or for side sword or anything like that.
Well, yeah, and Red Dragon has a new glove out that looks very promising, assuming it survives sort of, you know, these initial tests, but I think it will with some a couple of minor modifications. But I think you're right, you know, I can't use some of my sparring gloves for, you know, like some of my sabers because they just don't fit in the hilt. So I think that this is what I was saying earlier, is I think you're going to start seeing some specialization of equipment.
Mm.
You know, there isn't really a good rapier glove. You've got some of these leather gloves with a small bit of padding on the back.
Yeah.
But
although I would say with rapier, I'm not convinced that they actually need anything particularly better than what they have at the moment. But yeah, I think with gloves are one of those things where I think it's almost inevitable, unfortunately, that in the end we'll end up with different gloves for different weapons. Or maybe two types of gloves, and you can use one glove for those weapons and the other glove for those weapons or something like that. But longsword in particular, the hands are really vulnerable and take really hard hits. You've got rubbish hand protection on a longsword, and a lot of people are really bad at protecting their hands and get hit on the hands really, really hard. And a lot of people deliberately snipe hands because it's an easy target. So longsword especially needs the most hardcore hand protection. Any other pieces? What are your thoughts on plastrons, jackets, these kind of...
Yeah, that's a tricky one. We haven't had a HEMA death yet related to like a broken broken blade. But in my opinion, that's not a question of if that will happen, it's a question of when. And then we'll go through similar, you know, traumas that the sport fencing community went through over the years. You know, there are some plastic plastrons available.
Chest protectors, yeah.
Both for males and females. And they help a bit, but, you know,
they're more for impact, really, aren't they?
Yeah, they're really about spreading
impact. I have incidentally seen a blade go straight through one of those plastic chest protectors, make a hole in it like a bullet, so...
Yeah, they don't provide much penetration protection, although some... you have a similar phenomenon with neck gear. A lot of people, you know, I'm sorry, but if we're fencing steel swords, you should have steel protecting the...
I agree, although I think if we get the masks and the jackets right, then you don't necessarily need the throat protection anymore, because if they work together in the right way, you shouldn't need a separate throat.
Well, I think one of the best ideas that, you know, is difficult to do but perhaps could be explored more, is to have a bever that integrates with the jacket, perhaps slips in. This way the mask and the bib can sit behind the bever, you have full mobility, it doesn't impinge on your shoulder motion, but it's really not possible for anything.
Well, in fact, the Polish group, whose name I forget right now, but they've developed a kind of leather apron that has a gorget, almost like a bever built into it at the bottom of it. It does the same.
And I think that is a direction that should definitely be explored a little more, because it solves a number of problems.
Yeah, I mean, it potentially, if you get this sort of thing right, it could do away with the need for such a big bib on the mask.
Correct.
But yeah. Okay, well, loads of topics we've covered there, but hopefully it was interesting and entertaining to a good number of you. Thank you to Scott.
Thank you.
And I'm sure we'll be seeing more of Scott in some videos that I'll film over the next few days and during Fight Camp, talking about all sorts of other topics and maybe going into a few of the topics we discussed here in a bit more depth. So, thank you very much, guys. Take care.